folk who are complaining and crying and downtrodden, and they seem like they're out of work at times, and when they're not out of work, it seems like there's some pay cuts on the horizon. Even when your pay is not cut, it seems like in the marketplace, everything has gone up. It costs more to buy this or that, and even if they don't change the price, they've changed the amounts. So therefore, you buy a bag that used to be all full, it's now half full, and sometimes it's even half of a half, which makes it a fourth. And so we realize that it's hard times these days, and we need a provider. Let me tell you that if you look to your job, if you look to yourself, if you look to your family, you will be let down every time. But if you really want to be provided for, you must look to God, for He is the shepherd. The other thing that it says here is it says that the Lord is my shepherd, I shall not want. He maketh me to lie down in green pastures. You realize that He provides, but He also positions. See, I'm glad that He provides, but sometimes you must realize that His provision is in His position. Meaning that there are times when we are asking God to provide for us, but we don't realize that our provision is in the position that He puts us in. Oh, I wish you could. I wish I had some praying folk this morning. Sister Lisa, at least you awoke. So let me tell you, sometimes what God does is He positions us in order to provide for us. Sometimes we don't like where God puts us, but where God has put you is where He intends to feed you. So sometimes you've got to be glad because God provides, but also that God positions you. The text says that not only did He lead him there, He made him to stay there. There are times when we want to get up and run from the thing that God has for us, but we've got to stay still until God says move. And so the good shepherd, He provides and He positions. But then it says here, it says that He maketh me to lie down in green pastures. He leadeth me beside the still waters. And then He restoreth my soul. He leadeth me in the path of righteousness for His name's sake. He provides, He positions, but then He perfects. Right. See, the fact is, it says that He restores our soul. He leads us to the right place. He perfects us in time.
Yes.
See, there are times when we're going to go through some things, Sister Harris, but as we go through some things, as we're being led into and from some things, we must realize it's for our own benefit. That God is perfecting us. He's making us right in His presence. He's shaping us. He's molding us. He's making us, Brother Jay Sean. You realize that we're not perfect yet, but if we stay in God's hands, then ultimately He will shape us to where we need to be.
Amen.
Oh, I wish I had somebody here who realizes every now and then you've got to be in the hands of God. It may not feel good all the time, and He might have to rearrange you a little bit and turn you around sometime, but thank God that He has the hands to perfect us. Not only does He provide, position, and perfect, look at verse 3, He restoreth my soul. He leadeth me into the paths of righteousness for His name's sake. And then He goes on to say, yea, though I walk through the valley of the shadow of death, I will fear no evil, for Thou art with me, Thy rod and Thy staff, they comfort me. And so He provides, He positions, He perfects. And then number 4 should be verse 4, He's a path maker. He's a path maker. No, verse 3, I'm sorry. He's a path maker because He leads me into the paths of righteousness' sake. For righteousness' sake. See, God can make a way. God is one that allows us to go on the path. You know, some years ago, for those of you who are fans of The Ohio State University, that means that you've been to the Oval at some point in time. Well, when I was a young man, my Aunt Jean, many of you know her, she was going through the university. And when I was a young man, we would go and we would drop her off or pick her up from the university. And back then, what you see on the Oval, it didn't look like that. What the Oval looked like is a big park, Brother David, with a bunch of dirt paths going through it. There are a bunch of dirt paths going through it. And there was no real rhyme or reason to it. It was not symmetrical or any of those things. It was just based on where people like to walk or like to ride their bikes. And over time, there would be a path from this building to that building or a path from this building to that building, all in the grass, no real sidewalks going across the Oval. One day, they started paving some of those paths, and they finally realized, rather than to try to pave one of them, we must pave all of them. And so today, as you look at the Oval, you'll go through there, and you'll look, and if you can see it from overhead, you'll realize that it's not symmetrical. They're just paths that go through that any kind of way. It just depends on which kind of building somebody had to get to or from. I wish you would know it. I know you know that I'm an Ohio State fan, but I need you to know that God is like the oval. See, sometimes life is not symmetrical. So sometimes he doesn't put a path where you want it or where it seems like it ought to go. Every now and then you'll find out that there's a path that seems like it's out of place, but it still gets you to where you need to be. See, God will place a path where you don't think the path belongs, but because he understands the blueprint, because he understands the shortest direction, he will give you a path where sometimes you wouldn't put it. And so God has positioned us, but then he makes paths for us as he perfects us. Sometimes we say, but God, if I go down that path, I'm going to get in trouble. I'll be in danger if I go down that path. And I'm glad verse 4 comes up. Because then, Sister Shantae Shaw, it says, yea, though I walk through the valley of the shadow of death, I will fear no evil, for thou art with me, thy rod and thy staff, they comfort me. Sometimes it seems like if I go down this path, they will devour me. But he then says, no, don't worry about it. God will position you. He will protect you. He will provide for you. But then he'll be with you even when you're on a path that you don't think you ought to be on. He'll protect you in the midst of your enemies. He'll protect you in the midst of your storm. He is a protector. You can walk tall because you know you got God with you. Thank you. You can walk tall because you know God is with you. And it doesn't matter what you're going through. Oh, there's some folk in this room today who may be the doctor. It's told you that your path will be gone. Maybe the creditors have called you day and night. They torment you and said that your path will be long. Perhaps your life, your goals, your dreams, you feel like your path will be long. But no matter how long the path or how dark the road, we've got a God that will see us through. We've got a shepherd that can protect us even in the darkest hour. He said, even in the midst of my enemies, maybe you got some haters, but it really doesn't matter as long as God is there. Maybe you got somebody who's on your track and trying to take you back, but he's there. So he protects us. You know, the other thing I like about God, in verse 5, it says, thou preparest a table before me in the presence of my enemies. Thou anointest my head with oil, my cup runneth over. He prepares. He prepares. Sister Nora Green, if I was writing this sermon today, I'd probably use a fancier word that said he premeditated. He prepares. He is a premeditated God. See, what I like about God is, you know, Sister Kaniza, sometimes we used to get in little arguments and tiffs at school, and we had friends that said they had your back, right? See, they say, I got your back, right? And so whatever trouble you get in, they would jump in there and try to help you out. But see, God is better than that kind of friend. Because see, God doesn't just wait till something happens and then jumps in there and does something. It says that he's already prepared for me before they ever come to me. See, my God prepares for my enemies before they ever get to my door. He already has a plan. He already has it figured out. And the wonderful thing about God, since he created us, he's both Alpha and Omega. That means that whatever he starts, he can finish. So there are some things that maybe you think you don't quite understand, but let me tell you, God has already prepared more than a two-piece snack for your deliverance. He's already prepared a table so that you might be able to recline, relax and recline. See, this particular text, what this is really saying to us is it's really central to our theme and our season right now. Because, you know, right now we're going through this season that the Catholics call the Lenten season. At Liberty Hill, we're going through the 555 season. We've got weeks leading up to Passover whereby we realize that our Lord and Savior Jesus died on the cross and he was buried in a tomb, rose on the third day morning. See, the writer here, when he says he prepares a table for me in the presence of my enemies, is taking us back in time. He wants us to arrive again in Egypt and realize that in Egypt they were slaves. Even though their father Joseph had saved the Egyptians by helping them to get through the famine, the fact is they were slaves after Pharaoh came that did not know them. There they were slaves. There they had to work hard. There they were killed. There their babies were slaughtered. But yet God, through Moses, helped them to be delivered. Say, well, preacher, what does that have to do with verse 5? It is because as they were leaving, they had to prepare their meals quickly, which is one of the reasons that we had that flat bread on our communion table today. It is because they had to prepare their bread quickly. And so they left, and after they left, they realized that there were some things that God had done for them in order to get them to the Red Sea, through the Red Sea, and to the Promised Land. One of the things that he had done is he took them through a series of plagues. Those series of plagues, you know, ended as the firstborn died. He told them, he said, you know, what I want you to do is I want you to take an animal without blemish. I want you to slaughter it, put the blood over your doorpost, and then I want you to have a meal. I want you to sit down. I want you to hear this so you can really understand it, Brother Robert Smith. He said, I want you to sit down in the midst of all the death that will go on in Egypt. I want you to sit down and have a meal and realize that no death will come to your house as long as you're marked by the blood. Oh, I need you to get this story. The fact is that babies were dying in Egypt because God was delivering his people. In other words, the haters and the enemies had death in their camp, but God had blessed the camp of his people so that they might be able to sit down and have a feast and have a meal in the midst of their enemies dying. So when finally they got on the other side of the Red Sea, and the women folks started singing, it was a full shout fest going on right then with the Israelites. He said, let me tell you something. Now that y'all free, I don't ever want you to forget the fact that you're able to eat while everything else is dying. Oh, I wish I had somebody. I don't want you to ever forget the fact that you're able to recline and eat when there's a sword going through Egypt. I don't ever want you to forget the fact that I fed you when everybody else was dying. I don't want you to ever forget the fact that I delivered you across the Red Sea. So every year I want you to take a little time and have a little Thanksgiving Bible style. Now, I'm not talking about Indians and turkeys. I'm talking about lambs. I know Shirley Seaton said lambs and rams. I'm talking about lambs now. And I want you to have a little lamb dinner. I want you to have a little flatbread. And I want you to remember that I brought you out. I want you to sit back and recline. I want you to remember that no matter where you are and what you do, I'll prepare a table for you in the presence of your enemy. I wish I had somebody that realizes that even when you're going through your mess, you can still sit back and dine when God is in it. Because he'll bless you to relax because he's got everything you need. So he'll prepare a table in the presence of your enemies. Lest I keep you too long, let me tell you about the shepherd. He provides, he positions, he perfects, he makes paths. He's a protector and a provider. But then look at verse 6. Surely goodness and mercy shall follow me all the days of my life. I will dwell in the house of the Lord forever. See, he's a provider, a positioner, a perfecter, a pathmaker, a protector, a preparer. But then he preserves. Aren't you glad that he preserves?
Yes.
I'm not talking about your grandmama's preserves. I'm talking about God preserves. Right. Meaning that maybe you're going through this or that, and you feel like your number has finally been called. Mm-hmm. It's your turn, Brother Saunders, and you realize that it seems that they're having their way with you. But let me tell you that not only does God take care of us, but he has a place for us, not for a little while. I'm glad that he doesn't just provide temporary shelter, Sister Peaches. Because, you know, sometimes all we get is some temporary relief. But the psalmist allows us to know that once you're in his house, once you're in God's house, it's not just a day or a second or a moment, but he says that I'll dwell there forever. In other words, God has a place that is forever. I'm not looking for short term. I'm not looking for a minute. I'm not looking for a day. You'll find out that the seconds don't look so good. But Brother Saunders, I'll tell you, there are times when you might walk out there and you see the vision with Christ and you realize that they placed him on a hill called Calvary.
Yes.
Let me tell you, Deacon Johnson, out there on Calvary, some folks thought that it was all over with. There were some disciples that denied him. There were some that ran and hid. There were some that just couldn't believe that anything else would happen. They were crying and sniffling around because they saw that there was a cross on Calvary and Jesus was hung there. Deacon Hodge, Deacon David Hodge, sometimes there are folk who lose hope when they see the cross. There are others who lose hope when they see the blood coming from his vein. There are some that lost some hope because they said, well, it's over now. Well, we had a good run. He healed a few people and he said a few good things. Brother Med Shaw, we had a good run. It's finally over. They're about to bury that Negro. It's all over with him. Nothing else can be said about Jesus. Y'all might as well go home because there's nothing else to be seen here. There's some folk who look at you and they said, Brother Tim, there's nothing else to be seen here. Go on home. It's over. It's done with. They've already been crucified. But if they only knew about the God that I serve, because at the final hour, after the third day, he got up early one morning with all power in heaven and in earth. I'm glad that my enemies called me the comeback kid.